Verse 19, wherefore then serveth the law? The question naturally arises, if the law was not given for righteousness or salvation, why was it given? Why did God give the law in the first place if it cannot justify a person? The Jews believed that if they kept the law, they would be saved. When they heard that the gospel proclaimed a Christ who had come into the world to save sinners and not the righteous, when they heard that sinners were to enter the kingdom of heaven before the righteous, the Jews were very much put out. They murmured, "These last have wrought but 1 hour, and thou hast made them equal unto us, which have borne the burden and heat of the day?" Matthew 20, verse 12. They complained that the heathen, who at one time had been worshippers of idols, obtained grace without the drudgery of the law that was theirs. Today we hear the same complaints. What was the use of our having lived in a cloister 20, 30, 40 years? What was the sense of having vowed chastity, poverty, obedience? What good are all the masses and canonical hours that we read? What profit is there in fasting, praying, etc., if any man or woman, any beggar or scour woman, is to be made equal to us, or even be considered more acceptable unto God than we? Reason takes offense at the statement of Paul, "The law was added because of transgressions." People say that Paul abrogated the law, that he is a radical, that he blasphemed God when he said that. People say, "We might as well live like wild people if the law does not count. Let us abound in sin that grace may abound. Let us do evil that good may come of it." What are we to do? Such scoffing distresses us, but we cannot stop it. Christ himself was accused of being a blasphemer and rebel. Paul and all the other apostles were told the same things. Let the scoffers slander us, let them spare us not. But we must not, on their own account, keep silent. We must speak frankly in order that afflicted consciences may find surcease. Neither are we to pay attention to the foolish and ungodly people for abusing our doctrine. They are the kind that would scoff, law or no law. Our first consideration must be the comfort of troubled consciences, that they may not perish with the multitudes. When he saw that some were offended at his doctrine, while others found in it encouragement to live after the flesh, Paul comforted himself with the thought that it was his duty to preach the gospel to the elect of God, and that for their sake he must endure all things. Like Paul, we also do all these things for the sake of God's elect. As for the scoffers and skeptics, I am so disgusted with them that in all my life I would not open my mouth for them once. I wish they were back there where they belong, under the iron heel of the Pope. People foolish but wise in their conceits jump to the conclusion, if the law does not justify, it is good for nothing. How about that? Because money does not justify, would you say that money is good for nothing? Because the eyes do not justify, would you have them taken out? Because the law does not justify, it does not follow that the law is without value. We must find and define the proper purpose of the law. We do not offhand condemn the law because we say that it does not justify. We say with Paul that the law is good if it is used properly. Within its proper sphere, the law is an excellent thing. But if we ascribe to the law functions for which it was never intended, we pervert not only the law, but also the gospel. It is the universal impression that righteousness is obtained through the deeds of the law. This impression is instinctive and therefore doubly dangerous. Gross sins and vices may be recognized or else repressed by the threat of punishment. But this sin, this opinion of man's own righteousness, refuses to be classified as sin. It wants to be esteemed as high-class religion. Hence, it constitutes the mighty influence of the devil over the entire world. In order to point out the true office of the law, and thus to stamp out the false impressions of the righteousness of the law, Paul answers the question, "Wherefore then serveth the law?" with the words, verse 19, "It was added because of transgressions." All things differ. Let everything serve its unique purpose. Let the sun shine by day, the moon and the stars by night. Let the sea furnish fish, the earth grain, the woods, trees, etc. Let the law also use its unique purpose. It must not step out of character, and take the place of anything else, what is the function of the law? Transgression, answers the apostle.